Good afternoon. At the outset, I'd like to thank Dr. Snehal Madam and Dr. Prashant for giving me this opportunity. So, ours is an adult patient, a 42-year-old male. He was referred to us with the complaints of NVHA class 2 dyspnea. There was no history of angina, palpitations or syncope or any hypertension or diabetes mellitus. He was obese with a weight of 90 kilo. His examination showed S1 was normal with a wide fixed split and an ejection systolic murmur in the left upper sternal border. So his ECG showed first degree complete heart block, axis of 15 degrees, a left atrial enlargement, and incomplete right bundle branch block, and inverted T waves in one AVL and V2 to V6. X-ray showed cardiomegaly with increased pulmonary blood flow and prominent main pulmonary artery and right pulmonary artery. So this is the echocardiogram, which is showing a dilated right atrium. But this vascularity extending to the lateral one third, actually on the right side. Okay. Okay. So, sorry, echocardiography showed a dilated right atrium and right ventricle, and you could see an osseous secondum ASD shunting left to right. Actually, we couldn't get the TE pictures, but it was quite large, measuring around 28 millimeter.
On TE. Look that large. On that one, it looks quite small and restrictive.
Yeah.
On
the right, we couldn't get the TE pictures, actually, but it was quite.
Doesn't look terribly dilated.
Okay.
So, I mean, we're just trying to be critical as it goes along so that we can have the discussion, of course, afterwards as well.
Actually, in the TE, it looked quite significant. Okay. His peak pulmonary PR gradient was around 18 millimeter mercury.
So also, in this, the pulmonary artery flows are not as vigorous as you would expect in somebody with a large left-right shunt. I'm just contesting the whole notion that this is a large shunt.
Okay. So we took the patient for ASD device.
What are the numbers, cath numbers?
So we took a PA pressures. PA pressures was a systolic of 25. We usually, in our protocol, we don't take QB by QS if we feel that by examination, X-ray and ECG and echo, we feel it's a significant ASD.
Anyway, this was under general anesthesia, I presume, because I'm seeing a TE probe down his throat.
Actually, it was under, it was under general anesthesia, correct. This was under general anesthesia. Then after that, he came for follow-up. So when he came for follow-up, we found that he was having severe pulmonary arterial hypertension. We delved into the history and found that he had a history of snoring at night and some daytime somnolence. So a sleep study was done. So if you look at the findings of the sleep study, it's quite interesting. If you look to the right, actually, over here, you can see his whole sleep architecture has changed. Usually, N1, N2, N3, stage 1, 2, and 3 of sleep. So usually they spend only 5% of sleep in stage 1, and in stage 2, 50%. But you see his most of his sleep is in stage 1. So he's having recurrent arousals due to his obstructive sleep apnea, and he goes into stage 1 and comes out again. And the amount of REM sleep is usually around 20% of the sleep. He's only having 3% of that. Of the REM sleep. And the latency from sleep onset to REM is usually around 60 minutes to 120 minutes. It's only around, I think, 4 to 5 minutes over here. When come the one, this is what we'll mostly be familiar with, is the apnea hyperapnea index. So above 5 is suggestive of obstructive sleep apnea. He's 30, which is classification as severe obstructive sleep apnea. He was also having restless leg syndrome with his leg muscle leg movement index around 140, and above 20 is abnormal. So he's having a restless leg syndrome along with obstructive sleep apnea. So if I show you the right graph over here, these red arrows show the REM sleep. So when compared to the total sleep, the amount of REM sleep was very less. And this is the saturation line. So his baseline saturation was 95%, but during REM sleep, his saturation only recorded 88%. And most of his desaturations were happening during REM sleep over here, with a few desaturations happening during non-REM sleep. And when you see these apnea hypopnea attacks, They happen mainly during REM sleep and a few during non-REM sleep as well. So he was diagnosed by our pulmonologist as having severe obstructive sleep apnea. He was advised CPAP, but his mask, but he was not able to take it very regularly. So he also had a gastroesophageal reflux disease, and PPIs were started. We started on pulmonary vasculitis, and diuretics were also started, but he continued to have pulmonary arterial hypertension. So when we did an echocardiogram from him, so it was still showing a dilated RARB, but now the LA was also looking more dilated. His TAPSE was 18 millimeter. So when we saw his TR gradient, it was almost a severe pulmonary arterial hypertension with a right ventricular systolic pressure of 65 millimeter mercury. And peak PR was an incomplete jet, but was coming around 25 millimeter mercury. So we did a detailed assessment of his LV diastolic function, which is actually normal in the before we did the AST device closure. So his LV mass was normal, 50 gram per square meter, with his posterior wall thickness and interventricular septal normal, except for the interventricular septal thickness and systole of 16 millimeter. His cavity dimensions were normal, EF was normal. So his LA, his diastolic function measurements was LA volume was 42 ml per square meter, which was high. E velocity was high, E by A was also F 2.9. And his desession time was 118, which was low. And E by E prime was 26, so suggestive of diastolic dysfunction. And his, as you said, see, he had severe PEH. So he was a heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, that is diastolic heart failure with severe PH, but we didn't know the etiology. Of course, he had sleep apnea was one of the things. So now we took him for a cardiac cath. So his femoral artery saturation was 94 with a PO2 of 69, and pulmonary artery saturation was 47%, giving an oxygen extraction of 47% and a cardiac index of 1.1 liters per minute per meter squared, which was low. So baseline hemodynamics, on the left is the RA pressure with a mean of 10 and right ventricular end diastolic pressure with a mean of 10. And this is the left ventricular end diastolic pressure on a scale of 100, which was coming around 40, and the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure with a mean of 40 millimeter mercury as well. And this is comparison of the femoral artery and pulmonary artery pressure was 130 by 80 mean of 90 with severe pH of 80 by 40 mean of 50 millimeter mercury. So we gave him oxygen, and his RA mean pressure had actually increased to 16, and RV EDP was 18 millimeter mercury. He had a lot of respiratory variation because of his, he was also very anxious and his obesity related problems. So there's a lot of respiratory variation. His pulmonary capillary wedge pressure still remained at 40, and there was severe PH, you can see on the right side as well, so not much difference. So we were concerned about his coronary arteries. He didn't have any risk factors, but we did a coronary angiogram, and it was showing normal coronary arteries. So then after that, we decided to give IV furosemide, and we gave a 40 mg bolus of IV furosemide. And after 10 minutes, we took the pressures. So pulmonary capillary wedge pressure had come down to around 26, and left ventricular end diastolic pressure was also came down to around 26 millimeter mercury. His LV, which is equal to aortic pressures, was 130 millimeter mercury, and pulmonary artery had come down to 42 by 30, mean of 36, so mild pulmonary arterial hypertension. We gave, after that, NTG, that is nitrotriglycerin, and after that, his RA mean pressure and RV end diastolic pressure came down to 4 millimeter mercury, and pulmonary capillary wedge pressure came to 8 millimeter mercury, which was normal, and left ventricular end diastolic pressure to around 10 millimeter mercury. And his PA pressure was 28 by 17, mean of 24, which was the normal range. So this is a simultaneous tracing of the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure and left ventricular end diastolic pressure, showing no significant transmitral gradient. And comparison of the RV and LV pressures, showing that there's ventricular concordance, and there was no equalization of end diastolic pressures of the LV and RV on the right side, showing that there's no constrictive pericarditis. And a pullback from LV aorta showed a gain of around 18 millimeter, no significant left ventricular outflow tract obstruction. So if we see the summary of the table, actually, from baseline and then on IV lasix and NDG, we had a significant response with regard to the pulmonary artery pressures, which dropped from 80 by 40 mean of 50 to almost normal. And end diastolic pressures and pulmonary capillary wedge pressures also dropped down to normal. So he was started on diuretics, beta blockers, and AC inhibitors, and nitrates, and pulmonary vasodilators was stopped because it was a post-capillary pulmonary hypertension, and he was trying to continue with his CPAP therapy on night. So we went for a cardiac MRI at that point of time. So this is a CINI MRI, which is showing, if you see the myocardial wall thickness, there's an increased myocardial wall thickness at the apex when compared to the base, and a hypercontractility of the apex, showing a spade-like deformity was typical of apical HCM. This is the cine cut from the base to the apex over here, which is showing a contracting normal over here with a normal myocardial muscle thickness. But as we go towards the apex, you can see it's obliterated with increased myocardial muscle thickness coming to around 21 millimeter by MRI measurement. And this is a phase contrast MRI, which is just showing the reversal of flow from the left atrium to the pulmonary veins. You can see by the still picture showing due to severe LV diastolic dysfunction. So this is the gadolinium enhancement. So this is the ventricular cavity over here and myocardial wall over here, which is not showing any late gadolinium enhancement. And this is the myocardial tagging, which is equivalent to your strain on echo, a speckle tracking, which is showing a decreased intrinsic contractility at the LV apex. So these are the chamber volumes. So basically, his left ventricle and right ventricle chamber volumes were normal when we compared it to the Journal of Cardiovascular Magnetic Resonance Imaging, and his LV mass was also 73 gram per meter squared, which was normal. So we did a speckle tracking echo for strain, and if you see the bullseye plot over here, the apex, the segment 17 or the apex region, and the segments around that were showing less strain, around -4 to -6. But if you see the basal segments and mid segments, they were having normal strain, which is also denoted by these lines. The green and the indigo were near the apex, so they were having less strain. So basically, it was a patient with apical HCM with an ASD and also having obstructive sleep apnea. So he was continued on his beta blockers and judicious use of diuretics, and he's currently doing well right now. So when we reviewed the literature, we found there were a few cases of apical HCM associated with ASD which were managed differently. So this was a study from Japan, which was published in International Journal of Cardiology. So this in this patient, he had a HCM, apical HCM with an ASD. And the ASD, when they calculated the QP by QS, it was more than 3.1:1. And they did not do the ventricular end-diastolic pressures, but they decided to close the ASD with a surgical patch, and the patient was doing well. Another patient who had a left, which was published by Italian group, who had apical HCM with a patent foramen ovale. They balloon occluded the patent foramen ovale, and they found that the left ventricle end diastolic pressure increased from 5 to 15, and so they decided not to close that small AST. And another patient with the apical hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and atrial septal effect, which was part of a multi-organ syndrome. Two siblings were having amenorrhea with the renal failure and hypothyroidism, and they were just given medical management. So this was a nice paper from CAT-CVA, published by the Virginia group. It was a patient with hypertrophic cardiomyopathy and ASD and pulmonary arterial hypertension. So this patient was a 60-year-old female who had also had a COPD, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. So she was having suprasystemic PA pressures with an ASD. So they had baseline PA pressures of 120 by around 40, which was suprasystemic, and they occluded the ASD, which increased from 120 to around 150. And after giving diuretics and prostacycline, it came down to baseline. The PA pressures came down to baseline, which was still suprasystemic. And the LA mean also increased after the ASD device and came back down to baseline. But they decided to release the device. So they released the device, and after 6 months, this patient was doing well with half PA pressures, and NYHA class 4 came down to NYHA class 2. So some closing thoughts. So it's important to identify, especially in adult patients, associated important and difficult to find functional and morphological alterations of the myocardium if we do structural interventions like this, because they could lead to problems after the device closure. And subtle findings on the ECG, like the negative T waves in which extended up to V5 to V6, should be more looked into. Of course, this patient with apical HCM didn't have the giant negative T waves that you usually see, but still they were negative up to V6. So thank you very much.
What made you think of giving NTG? I don't know how that thought crossed you. I mean, what was
because
the basis?
It was a left ventricular end-diastolic, left ventricular severe diastolic dysfunction. So after giving IV Lasix, we thought we'll give either Mildenone or NTG. Then we spoke with our adult colleagues, and they decided to give NTG. So we gave.
Who had apical HCM, proven apical HCM, that I've put in a device after doing balloon occlusion. So what I did was I did balloon occlusion and got the EDPs and the numbers after balloon occlusion. They weren't as high as what you found here. They were modestly elevated, and then we closed the ASD, and he still follows up with us on beta blockers, and I'm not sure, but we did it.
The problem is apical HCM many times is missed on your routine transthoracic echo, so ECG usually leads to the diagnosis.
It's a trap which sometimes we fall, but I think we just only wish in retrospect that we, if we would have been a little more serious about the X-ray ECG, we might have got it right. Even eventually, finally, everything is fine. A lot of literature is discrepant between the two. Some people say that just don't close it. Some say that you diurese them, do a balloon occlusion, put them on therapy, and sometimes you might end up doing a finally a good thing. So it's a very interesting case.
I was astonished by that last article I showed. Even with suprastomic PA pressures, they released the ASD device and that patient is doing well, that CATSI way.
Bias there. The but ones that made it will come find their way into the literature. The ones that are embarrassing won't find their way into the literature.
Yeah. If you're in such an obese fellow with that much of ASD, is not going to do much to the patient. You know.
Actually, it was a large ASD and he has got some symptoms. So, essentially, the cardiomyopathy part was not recognized, baseline. Then looking at that, we thought it's a large shunt. Suppose if you have a frank, it's a complete HOCM or HCM, probably it is contraindicated. Or you have to put a flow regulator or fenestrated device. Here, I think putting this or fenestration may be an option, I think.
T inversion in lead 1 and V5, V6 is a hard data. We should have probably registered that.
Yes, sir. Yeah. If we had seen the typical apical HCM giant negative T waves, then this no doubt. Here it is quite subtle actually.
See, 1 and AVL. Look at 1 and AVL. 1 and AVL T is never normally like this.
Yeah.
But this is retrospective.
Not just an ASD, but even the VSDs that we have operated, who are otherwise perfectly fine, but their myocardiums are not normal. The PDAs, they're definitely abnormal. One day we'll find the genes that do this, but I think they all need to be looked at. And I don't think we should just let them go out into the community, because I think they'll come back and bite us. Because I've just started looking at them, and you know, it's just not normal. That's my only point I would like to add.
Thank you.